Good morning.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Isn't it a wonderful day? Temperature's not bad out there this morning. My name's Clark Pugh, and I welcome you to Barbee Memorial this morning. We're a little light, but that's okay. We're glad we're here. We're glad that we're able to praise the Lord. Every day above ground is a good day.
That's right.
Well, I'm not sure. It's like a bird in the hand. I'm not sure. When we pass away, we'll be with Jesus. That's probably a better deal, isn't it? Well, anyway. wanted to remind you about the blue and the orange cards and the seat back. If you're a visitor, fill out the orange card and drop it in the narthex offering box. If you have a prayer or a request or a praise, fill out the blue card, put it in the offering box in the narthex. This morning, after the service, we're going to start taking down the greenery. So if you have a few minutes to stay and help us take all that stuff down, we should appreciate it if you can. And I think that's all we have. Now, we'll prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we listen to the prayer. If you stand and join me in the call to worship this morning. Praise be to the Lord, my rock. He is my loving God and my fortress, my stronghold and my deliverer, my shield in whom I take refuge. Lord, what are human beings that you care for them? Mere mortals that you think of them. They are like a breath. Their days are like a fleeting shadow. Part your heavens, Lord, and come down. Touch the mountains so that they smoke. I will sing a new song to you, my God. Blessed are the people whose God is the Lord.
This morning, you're going to get the chance to choose a favorite Christmas carol out of the hymnal. I'm going to choose the first one. You're going to need your hymnals that are in front of you, the blue hymnal, and we're going to start with 152, Angels We Have Heard on High. We'll do one verse, and then I'm going to ask for someone to volunteer another song and the page number, and we'll do one verse of that, and we'll try to do four. right now, and then at the end of the service, we'll do four more. So let's start with 152.
Saints of the ages.
We profess that God fulfilled the promise that he had made to the early fathers by the mouth of his holy prophets when he sent his only and eternal Son into the world at the time set by him. The Son took the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of man, truly assuming a real human nature, with all its weaknesses except for sin, being conceived in the womb of the Virgin Mary by the power of the Holy Spirit without male participation, and not only assumed human nature as far as the body is concerned, but also a real human soul
in order that he might be the real human being. For since the soul had been lost as well as the body, he had to assume them both, to save them both together. In this way, he is truly our Emmanuel, that is, God with us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Today I'm here to visit with you regarding my cousin Rodney and Christiana von Schooten and Barbie's continued support of their mission. They live in Hong Kong and serve Christians throughout China. In his current letter, Rodney points out that the Lord has opened the door to increased opportunities in Hong Kong and China. A local pastor has invited them to join in a weekly Wednesday night meeting at the Chinese church. Rodney points out that the use of Zoom has been remarkable, with people asking good questions, and that more of the people who are joining in are from various cities and communities in China. The Van Schooten children are all were home for Christmas in Hong Kong last year, but that has changed for this year. The getting together was via Zoom this Christmas. Carissa is in a new apartment in Berlin where she is studying Arabic and German language. Carly has moved to San Diego where she works at a local church and is writing. Daniel and wife Kaylin are working in Denver. Josiah also is moving to Denver and living with Daniel and Kaylin. Josiah will start a new job in a dialysis clinic as a patient care technician in January. They all thank us for our partnership in ministry in 2020. Rodney and Christiana say that it is truly humbling and at the same time uplifting privilege to serve our Lord together. If you would like to make a donation to help them continue as missionaries in Hong Kong, you may use the white envelope in the chair packet and mark it for the Van Schooten mission. Please deposit it after the service in the donation box. For those wishing to read more about their mission, I will have extra newsletters from Rodney out in the narthex after the service. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. We come now to the time of the prayer of God's people as we join together in coming to the throne of mercy and grace and making our requests known to the Lord. And so, as usual, I will pause in the middle of my prayer, and I invite you to name off those burdens upon your heart as we bring them to the Lord together. So let's go to the Lord. Lord Jesus, on this cusp of a new year, as we say goodbye to 2020, which has been a struggle for so many, Lord, we pray and we bring these concerns to you, knowing, Lord, that you are indeed faithful. You are full of grace and mercy, that our prayers don't simply bounce off the ceiling, but that you are present in power through your Holy Spirit, and you desire to work in the midst of your people and in the midst of our prayers. And so, Lord, we bring our prayer concerns to you now. God of love and grace, we do lift up these prayer requests to you, and we join together in hearts and minds and ask you to be at work in them. We ask you to heal for those who are struggling today with health issues, whether that be physical or mental. Lord, we ask you to reach your hand of healing into their lives. Lord, we pray for our friends, family, neighbors, those who are far from you today, and ask you by your grace to send your Holy Spirit to soften their hearts to the message of the gospel and to work in their lives to bring them to that place where they trust you, Lord Jesus. And Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray for our national leaders in this coming year, Lord, as there's likely to be a changes, major changes, Lord, and we pray that you will be at work giving our leaders wisdom and guidance each step of the way. But Lord, we know that you are sovereign, that you are at work, despite all our fears and whatever concerns we might have in the coming year. Lord, we know that you are in charge. And Lord, we pray for our military men and women, many of whom are far away from home today. Lord, we ask you for your grace and mercy upon their lives. And Lord, we continue to pray for our missionaries, as Bob has lifted up a very important one. And Lord, we pray for each of our missionaries, ask you to continue to work in power in their lives as you continue to build your kingdom through their faithful work. Thank you, Lord, for your presence in our midst. And Lord, we pray now as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Now, another chance to do two more. Who has one that they'd love to do? Joan?
151.
151, thank you. Go tell it on the mountain. You sing better standing? Do so. If you'd rather sit, sit.
Verses 1 through 13, Luke 4, verses 1 through 13. And if you are able, if you'd like to stand with me in the reading of this of God's word, Luke 4, verses 1 through 13. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone." The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. Let's pray together. Lord, as we spend time this morning in your precious word, we've sung these wonderful hymns of your birth, Lord. We just pray that you will be present with us in this time as we prepare our hearts and our minds for this coming new year. Lord, put us in the right place for that. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, I read of a Charlotte, North Carolina man who purchased a case of very rare, very expensive cigars. So he decided to insure them against fire, among other things. But within a month, having smoked his entire stockpile of cigars and without having made even his first premium payment on the policy, the man decided to file a claim against the insurance company. In his claim, the man stated the cigars were lost in a series of small fires. The insurance company refused to pay, citing obvious reasons, of course, that the man had consumed the cigars in the normal fashion. But the man sued. And I guess he had a pretty good lawyer because he won. In delivering the ruling, the judge agreeing that the claim was frivolous, although he stated, nevertheless, the man held a policy from the company in which it had warranted that the cigars were insurable and also guaranteed that it would insure against fire without defining what it considered to be unacceptable fire and was obligated to pay the claim. So rather than enduring a lengthy and costly appeal process, the insurance company accepted the ruling and paid the man $15,000 for the rare cigars he lost in the fires. After the man cashed the check, however, the insurance company had him arrested on 24 counts of arson. With his own insurance claim and testimony from the previous case being used against him, the man was convicted of intentionally burning his insured property and sentenced to 24 months in jail and a $24,000 fine. The man's attempt to take a shortcut in recouping his loss ultimately cost him his freedom and all that he thought he gained and even more. As I was reading this story it occurred to me that it's somewhat similar with us and our faith. Shortcuts often lead to disaster. See, the man rationalized his way to doing what was wrong, and he paid the price. When we rationalize our way to shortcuts, to make life easier, more comfortable, we too find ourselves paying the price in our character, in obedience to God. This week our calendar tells us that it's going to be a new year, 2021. And after such a difficult last year, a new year gives us hope that things will be different, better, brighter. We tend to be filled with new hope as a new year approaches. And I'd like us to kind of enter into this passage this morning with that same sense of hope. See, in this series in the Gospel of Luke, my desire for us was to realign our views to the reality that the calling to be a Christian is really quite a revolutionary calling, not a comfortable calling.
We must together grasp that if our desire is to reach our community for Christ. See, most of us have become accustomed to a culture that is overall consistent with a Christian worldview. Our nation and our worldview, though, has departed from that Christian worldview and that ethic, and instead has embraced philosophies that are in many ways opposed to the Christian worldview. Therefore, to live faithfully, we must continue to faithfully embrace God's values and God's truths, which ultimately are going to make us revolutionaries in our times. As James puts it in his letter, friendship with the world is enmity toward God, and so it is now in our coming culture. See, Jesus' ministry starts off by facing off with Satan. He's led into the desert by the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity. See, the time of testing and facing off with the enemy is really all in God's plan. In fact, Luke tells us not only that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert, but that he was also full of the Holy Spirit. This was all by the direction and will of God. And we're also told that Jesus fasted for 40 days leading up to this time of testing. Jesus, who we're told in scriptures is the new Adam, is tested in the desert after 40 days of fasting. The old Adam, well, he lived in paradise, and he was quite well fed and had plenty to drink when he faced off against Satan. See, the reason I bring this up is the context of this passage in Luke. At the end of chapter 3, right before this time of testing, Luke reminds us there that, of the genealogy of Jesus with these words, the son of Adam, the son of God. So Luke wants us to make that connection, to compare the first Adam with the second Adam. Now there are some very important truths for us to understand, and this brings me to point one on your outline. For those of you who like to take notes, it's on the back inside page. And the point one is the words allows and purposes. Allows and purposes. God is always sovereign and allows no temptation except that which furthers his broader purposes. And then I'll go ahead and give you point two while we're at it. And it's the words tempts and evil. Tempts and evil. See, God never directly tempts anyone, and he never causes evil, though he allows it. See, without both these important truths planted firmly in our minds, we're likely to fall into two very popular and distinct errors. The first is that God always means for us to be happy, comfortable, wealthy, and healthy all the time. So any trials and tests that come into our lives have to come from outside of God's control. This is really a very pernicious and terrible error. And it's currently blinding many parts of the church today. And so we need to repent of those kinds of errors, or we're going to entirely lose out on God's revolutionary and counterworldly plans for each of our lives and for the plans for our church. Secondly, is the false idea that God must either be unable to stop the trials and tests and challenges and evil that enter our lives, or he's really not good or holy after all. See, both of these positions entirely misunderstand who God is and what he is like. They create God as a big Santa Claus in the sky who is always out there to make our lives pleasant. And it fails to understand something that is point three on your outline. And it's the word character. God is much more interested in our character than in our comfort. Back to this event in Jesus. See, for 40 days here, we're told this is going on. He's going to fast for 40 days. And this is connecting Jesus to Moses. We saw the connection to Adam, but he's also being connected to Moses here. Because Moses too was tested for 40 days to prepare him to receive the law. It also alludes to the Israelites wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. See, Jesus is clearly held up here as a new and better Moses, and he will succeed where Israel as a whole had failed. Now let's take a look at the nature of these temptations. There were three distinct temptations we're told about here. Two of them specifically make Jesus' sonship the issue. Do you see that? Satan tempts Jesus to act in a way that supports his sonship. He starts the temptation like this. If you are truly God's son, then... See, now Satan knows full well who Jesus is. He knows that Jesus is the Son of the Father, the Son of God, the second person of the Godhead. He isn't confused about any of this. But what he wants to do is to lure Jesus to act independently of the Father, and therefore making him out to be a rebellious son. See, the first temptation questions God's provision and God's care. Satan tempts Jesus by implying that Jesus' sonship must mean that God doesn't want him to starve in the desert. So the mighty son should simply turn stone into bread and meet his basic needs under his own power. Certainly you are God the Father's beloved son, beloved child, and the Father is loving and caring and kind, and he'd never want you to starve. Don't we hear echoes of this kind of temptation, even from some so-called Christian leaders today, some corners of Christian media? God would never want you to have your basic, miss out on your basic needs. God would never want you to be without something that your heart desires. He'd never want you to be without a nice house, maybe a new Lamborghini, a nice private jet. He'd certainly never want you to do without anything that our popular culture tells you you should want and have. Or worse yet, God would never want you to deny feelings that are arising from within you. If you're a young man, but you have feelings that you're actually a woman, then that's what you truly must be. And God would never deny that to you. Or if you have unnatural desires for people of the same gender, well, then you must act on that. Because certainly God would not want to deny that to you. See, in this view, God is in the business of providing all the luxuries of life and certainly all the basic needs that his children require. And all your feelings must be affirmed by God. So all you have to do is to take it. All you have to do is to be strong enough to think highly enough of yourself to know that you deserve all the nice things this world has to offer. You can have all of this on your own, and you can be whatever your feelings tell you that you ought to be. Never mind God's word on the issue. Never mind objective truth. Never mind objective biology. God would never want you to deny yourself. But Jesus understands that the temptation isn't a challenge to be strong, to be independent from God. This is point four on your outline. And it's the word independent. The first temptation is to be independent from God. See, this independence leads to true spiritual failure. Many years back, I was visiting a Presbyterian Church USA in Wisconsin. And the pastor actually twisted the words of Scripture to say that God wanted us to be independent of him. That true Christian maturity was to ultimately do away with our dependence on God. Instead of echoing Christ's words, this so-called Christian leader was actually echoing Satan's words. And he twisted the Bible just as Satan did. And Jesus' reply to Satan is the same, I think, reply as to this so-called pastor. And it comes from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3, which in its entirety reads like this. He humbled you, causing you to hunger and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. See, what Jesus is doing is arguing that life is run by more than food. In fact, in the larger picture of reality, when our priorities are put before us, life is not defined by bread at all. And this brings us to point five, which are the words will and truly. Life is defined by doing God's will and depending on his leading as given us in his word, the Bible. For to truly follow God is to truly live. Now let's take a look at the second temptation, which is an invitation to worship Satan and abandon loyalty to the Father, which of course would be a direct repudiation of the first of the Ten Commandments, you shall have no other gods before me. Now at first glance, this really doesn't seem to be all that much of a temptation at all. Very few of us are really tempted to worship Satan, and certainly not Jesus. Jesus would never do that, but there's something much deeper here. Satan allows Jesus to see all the kingdoms in the world and promises him authority over all of them if he'll only worship him. See, the proposal is an alliance between the Son of God and Satan. The temptation is not only to join Satan, but for Jesus to excuse himself from all that lies ahead in his ministry. He can leave behind the rejection and the suffering for quick access to power. Now, Satan doesn't have great authority and power in this. Satan does have great authority and power in this world, but he really cannot grant this wish. The proposal is a delusion and a lie, as are all of Satan's attempts to get us off track. In fact, this is a very strong temptation. It's a temptation to have all that you want and that all you have to do is compromise with the world. You can have access to the halls of power, have powerful political allies. You can control the direction of things, our world, our nation. And all you have to do is compromise away our beliefs and our ethics. We just have to put in the right people in power, the right powerful allies, so that we can force the direction of the nation, force the direction of our world into the directions that we want things to go. I see Christians falling for this temptation of Satan every day. For what? For what we think will be political influence to change things for the better. See, the problem is that when you dine with the devil, as it's often said, you need a long spoon. Have you ever heard that saying? You can't compromise with the world. You cannot be a friend of the world. You cannot take the shortcuts, which is point six on your outline, and it's the word shortcuts. Shortcuts only lead to death and destruction. See, the way Jesus replies tells us a lot. Going Satan's way is not the way to gain power, but to lose it. There is no quick and easy road to messianic glory or to spiritual survival in a hostile world. Jesus instead chooses to receive from the Father what is only the Father's to give. So Jesus replies from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 13. And his point is simple. Only one person, one being in the universe is worthy of worship, is worthy of devotion and love of this kind. Everything else is idolatry. Only God. See, the verse he quotes follows right after the great Shema of the Jew, which the Jews recited daily. Shema just simply means, is the first word in the Hebrew there, which means listen or hear. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God, the Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength. See, that verse notes one other important aspect of reality, that with worship comes service. True service means remaining allied to God. See, what Satan was really offering was a shortcut, a compromise. that Jesus could get all that he came for without having to go the way of the cross. He didn't need to die for the sins of the world to rescue whosoever would believe in him. No, all he had to do was compromise with Satan and the world, and he could have it all. But the cost was to abandon all that he was. Let's go to the third temptation. We'll kind of bring them all together. The third temptation is Jesus is taken to the temple in Jerusalem. Probably the royal porch on the temple's southeast corner, which rises over a cliff and over the Kidron Valley, 450 feet below. Josephus, the Jewish historian, once wrote that just looking over the edge made people dizzy. Satan himself quotes from Scripture now, from Psalm 91, verses 11 and 12, which reads, "For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in your hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." See, Satan's point is simple. If God protects his own and you are his son, then you can jump and not worry. See, what he's doing here is twisting Jesus' first defense. Remember Jesus' first defense? He is saying that a miraculous act like this would show just how dependent Jesus is on the Father. Certainly the Father will not let you be crushed. Now this sounds very spiritual, but Jesus understands. He knows that the Father has not asked Jesus to jump from the temple. That kind of action artificially creates a need for God to act, since it puts God in a kind of a show-me position. The action is really a private test of God, and genuinely a sign of a lack of faith. So Jesus replies with Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 16. "Do not put the Lord your God to the test as you did at Massah." Jesus will not test God or make his ministry about flashy displays done for selfish purposes. The ministry of the Messiah is not a traveling magic miracle roadshow. Satan's temptations today are really basically the same as they have always been. He always tries to subvert our walk with God. He always tries to stop us from being revolutionaries in a spiritual battle. He wants us to compromise. He wants us to find shortcuts. And in response, we must rely on God, and in some cases, walk the hard road with him. Anything we do independent of the Lord ultimately expresses a lack of connection to him. During his reign, King Frederick William III of Prussia found himself in trouble. Wars had been costly, and in trying to build the nation, he was seriously short of finances. He couldn't disappoint his people, and to capitulate to the enemy was really something unthinkable. So after careful reflection, he decided to ask the women of Prussia to bring their jewelry of gold and silver to be melted down for their country. And for each ornament received, he determined to exchange a decoration of bronze or iron as a symbol of his gratitude. Each decoration would be inscribed with the words, "I gave gold for iron, 1813. You know, the response was overwhelming. And even more important, these women prized their gifts from the king more highly than their former jewelry. The reason, of course, is clear. The decorations were proof that they had sacrificed for their king and for their nation. You know, indeed, it became even unfashionable to wear jewelry. And it was at that point was established what is referred to as the Order of the Iron Cross. Members wore no ornaments except a cross of iron for everyone to see. See, when we Christians come to our King, we too exchange the trappings and values of our former life for a cross. Christ is our ultimate example of self-sacrifice. And he calls us to take up our cross and follow him. See, God's word is the only way we have to understand God's will and his direction. Satan will twist God's word, but we must always seek to discern God's word honestly and with wisdom. Loyalty to God involves loyalty to his word. In a world that has decided that there is no authority other than our own hungers and desires, it is truly a revolutionary concept to proclaim that God has spoken and that God speaks today through his word and through the word, his son. See, Jesus is in the midst of temptations. It stood solidly with the Father and with his inerrant word. The temptations we face are to be resisted in such a way that reveals our character and where our authorities lie. This is really very revolutionary. Jesus never takes shortcuts, never rationalizes away what is true and right. The character he reveals is our calling too. Jesus could easily have said that the Father wouldn't want his son to starve or to suffer or be rejected or to die. The kingdom of God would be coming to him anyway, so why does it matter how he receives it? But Jesus avoids this kind of end justifies the means thinking. As he responds to those undermining proposals of Satan. Which brings me to point 7 on your outline. And it's the word avoiding. We must be careful that the shortcuts that often become possible in life do not in fact reflect our attempt to rationalize avoiding God's will. See, tests in life aren't really bad. We're often put into these places by God. And the important issue is how we respond to those tests. Do I respond in a way that looks to God to guide me through it? Do I trust him? Or do I put him to the test? How do I respond to personal struggles in my life? Do I get angry? Do I seek to reassert my own control? Or do I rest in faith, looking for God's hand, and ask him what I should learn from what I am going through? Which brings me to point 8, and it's the word trials. See, if I'm to grow spiritually, I can expect trials. And I need to look to Jesus and his word for strength and direction in those trials. And the same is true for our congregation. If we're to grow as a congregation, we can expect trials. And we must corporately, constantly look to Jesus and his word for strength and direction, each and every step of the way. Now let me go back for a moment to the connection of Jesus and Adam. See, Jesus was tempted to turn stones into bread. For Adam, the temptation was that the tree was good for food. This is what John, the Apostle John, describes in his first letter as the lust of the flesh. Jesus was tempted, seeing all the kingdoms laid before him. Adam saw that the fruit was pleasing to the eyes. John describes this as the lust of the eyes. Jesus was tempted to jump and have his life saved in a spectacular, miraculous way. Adam was tempted with wisdom so as to not die. And John describes this as the pride of life. Jesus was tempted in every way as we are. Which brings me to point 9 on your outline, and it's the word ourselves. At the heart of each of those temptations is to depend on ourselves and live life on our terms as if God did not even exist. The final way of temptation is to try to force God to act on our behalf. And if he doesn't, then we're free to act and believe however we wish. If you care for me, God, then this situation will turn out this way. In effect, we test the emergency broadcast system of God's presence and presume on him how he should react. See, ultimately, this is our way of controlling God, not following his lead. We blame God whenever suffering occurs, at least indirectly. We may feel as if he abandoned us, when in fact he may be getting our attention, revealing a better way to us, or asking us to meet him in the midst of the adversity we're going through. You know, Elizabeth Elliot lost her husband, Jim, to murder and martyrdom by Latin American Indians in the mid-1950s. But instead of becoming embittered because life didn't turn out the way she wanted or the way she expected in serving the Lord, she turned her disappointing experience into an opportunity to listen to God in the midst of all the uncertainty, only to find a fresh ministry of depth in her testimony about how God cared for her in the midst of her disappointment. She did not abandon God or test him. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who wrote from a gulag imprisonment, he wrote this: "Bless you, prison. Bless you for being in my life. For there, lying on the rotting prison straw, I came to realize that the object of life is not prosperity, as we are made to believe, but the maturing of the human soul." Francis Havergal once wrote this poem for the new year in his time, which I'd like to close with today. "Another year is dawning. Dear Father, let it be, in working or in waiting, another year with thee. Another year of progress, another year of praise, another year of proving thy presence all the days. Another year of mercies, of faithfulness and grace, another year of gladness, the glory of thy face. Another year of leaning upon thy loving breast, another year of trusting, of quiet, happy rest. Another year of service, of witness for thy love. Another year of training for holier work above. Another year is dawning, dear Father, let it be, on earth or else in heaven, another year for thee." Let's pray together. Gracious Lord, as we look forward to another year, Lord, may our prayer be similar to that of Havergal's. But ultimately, this is another year for thee. Another year to draw closer to you. Another year to rely more deeply upon you each step of the way, as we seek to reach our community for you, Lord Jesus. May we learn to be ever more dependent upon you. Maturity is not independence of you, but is rather a much deeper dependence upon your grace and your mercy. Lord, may it be as you desire. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I now invite you to join with me in our corporate prayer of confession, which comes from Psalm 5. Let's pray this prayer together. Lord, hear our words and our groanings, O Lord. Give attention to our cry for mercy. You are not a God who delights in wickedness. Evil may not dwell with you. The boastful shall not stand before your eyes. You hate all evildoers. You destroy those who speak lies. You abhor the bloodthirsty and deceitful. But, O Lord, we are evildoers. We are boastful, deceitful, and bloodthirsty. By your mercy alone, by the abundance of your steadfast love, may we enter your house. Because of your Son, O Lord, let us find refuge in you. Take away our sins and let us sing for joy. Cover us with your favor as with a shield, for the sake of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's just take a moment of silent confession together. Gracious and loving God, in your mercy and in your
forgiveness we trust today, knowing how truly far short we have fallen of your desires for us as individuals and corporately this last year. Lord, we seek to trust you more deeply in this coming year. We seek to follow you more deeply and to lean on your grace and mercy and strength each step of the way. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Our first selection is from Karen, and it's page 171, Hark the Herald. Feel free to stand with me. 171.
Thank you.
Now I invite you to go out with these words from Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. It's in, go in his peace.
Thank you.